Reading from the Synaxarion through the prayers of Holy Fathers, Lord Jesus Christ, our God, have mercy on us. Amen. On the 25th of the month of December, we keep the feast of the Nativity according to the flesh of our Lord and God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Caesar Augustus, the first Roman emperor, who reigned from around 30 BC until the year of our Lord 14, having made all the peoples of the known world subject to his sole authority, decided in the height of his power to take a census of the vast population of his empire, and he thereby became unwittingly the instrument of the realization of the plan of God. For in bringing together and establishing peace and harmony among the many peoples of his immense empire, with their diverse customs and languages, he prepared them for the revelation of the one God in three persons, and thus opened the way for the universal proclamation of the gospel, in accordance with the divine promise, I shall give thee the nations for thine inheritance. Thus the first census prophetically foretold the enrollment of the elect in the book of life. The imperial decree reached Palestine, where Quirinius was the governor of Syria, and occasioned the fulfillment of the prophecy that the Messiah would be born of the lineage of Judah at the city of Bethlehem, the native city of King David. For Joseph, who was then with Mary at Nazareth in Galilee, had to be enrolled in Bethlehem, the town of his forefathers, even though the pregnancy was well advanced of her whom all took to be his wife. On their arrival, they found the place crowded with people from all over the country, who like themselves had come for the census. Unable to find lodging in the inn, they had to take shelter for the night outside of the town in a cave that was used as a cattle shed. Since Mary felt that the time had come for her to be delivered of her child, Joseph settled her as best he could in the straw, close by the ox and the ass, which they found there, and he went out in haste to look for a midwife. On his way, he noticed that the whole of nature had suddenly become utterly still, as though seized with astonishment. Birds hung motionless in midair, men and beasts stopped in their tracks, the waters ceased from flowing. The continuous movement that leads everything from birth to death and imprisons all in vanity was suspended for a moment. For in that moment, the eternal entered within the heart of time. The pre-eternal God became a newborn child. Time and history now took on a new dimension. The universal hush, though, did not last, and everything appeared to resume its normal course. Joseph found the midwife who was coming down the mountain and told her on the way to the cave of her who was about to give birth. But upon reaching the cave, they were prevented from entering by a thick cloud which covered it, like that on Mount Sinai when God revealed himself to Moses. The woman fell on the ground and cried out, My soul has been magnified this day, for my eyes have seen a wonder. A Savior is born in Israel. When the cloud lifted and gave place to a dazzling light, which decreasing little by little, finally allowed them to enter. They were in excess of mind to behold the All-Holy Lady sitting beside the manger where she had placed the child, which she had wrapped in swaddling clothes. Joseph already knew from the angel that the Blessed Virgin had conceived the Savior by the operation of the Holy Spirit, and he contemplated the little child lying in the straw. He silently adored the Messiah, awaited and foretold by his fathers for so many generations. Indeed, what could be more amazing than this sight? How could words express it? The Almighty God and Creator of all things became a lowly, weak creature, a little homeless sojourner, yet without ceasing to be divine and uncircumscribed. The Word of God took upon himself the heaviness of our flesh, and clothing himself in our humanity, he made of it a royal robe. He who is seated in impassibility upon his heavenly throne, attended by myriads of the heavenly hosts who glorify him without ceasing, accepts now to be contained in an obscure, narrow cave, rejected, despised by all. He who is of divine nature humbles himself, emptying himself and taking the form of a servant and being born in the likeness of men. He who cannot be touched, accepted to be wrapped in swaddling bands, that he might release us from sin and cover us with divine glory, who had been disgraced. God's only Son, he who is in the bosom of the Father from all eternity, became Son of Man and Son of the Virgin, without ceasing to be God, in order to become the firstborn among many brethren, to grant to men the dignity of becoming the adoptive sons of God. He is laid in a crib and gazed on by the ox and the ass, whereby the prophecies are fulfilled. For Habakkuk had said, in the midst of two animals shalt thou be known. In Isaiah, the ox knows his creator, the ass his master's crib. He who gives food to all flesh by his providence is laid in the manger of these animals without reason, which symbolize both the Jews and the Gentiles, in order to heal mankind of its illness and reconcile those whom hatred had kept apart, by offering himself as the sustenance of all, the true bread of life. Moreover, in this scene, say the Holy Fathers, an image of the church is presented for our contemplation. The crib represents the chalice containing him who became flesh on this day and gives himself as the food for the life of the whole world. The Virgin is at once his throne and the altar of the sacrifice, the cave a temple, the angels, Joseph and the shepherds serving as deacons and acolytes, and the Lord himself, the great high priest, at his divine liturgy. Now a countrywoman called Salome, who had chanced to pass that way, learned from the midwife of the wonder that had taken place, but she did not show the same faith. She thought it beyond belief that a virgin could give birth, and not only that, but still remain a virgin after bringing forth a child. With incredulity, not unlike that of the Holy Apostle Thomas, she dared to extend a shameless hand towards the body of the All-Holy Lady. Her hand was immediately struck with a palsy, and she cried out, "Woe is me for my impiety and unbelief! I have provoked the living God. Look, my hand has been shriveled as though by fire and is dropping off." Falling to her knees, she implored the Lord to take pity on her, at which an angel appeared and allowed her to take the divine infant in her arms. And with sincere faith, now full of the fear of the Lord, she exclaimed, "I bow down before him, for a great king has now been born in Israel." She was healed immediately. But the angel counseled her to keep all these wonders to herself until the Lord would make himself known. The marvel accomplished this day in the humble cave in Bethlehem is the fulfillment of all the revelations of the prophets of Israel and the outcome of a patient preparation of mankind through all the centuries since David, Abraham, Noah, and Adam. Today, in these last times, God sends us his only Son by whom he had made all the ages, and thereby reveals to us in the world the great mystery of our salvation, wrapped in silence and kept hidden in God, in the inexpressible counsel of the three persons of the Most Holy Trinity since before the creation of the world. To see this day dawn, the sun, the expanse of the heavens, the earth, and all living things were created. That the Word made flesh and dwelt among us is a mystery beyond the grasp of human nature or human understanding, and unfathomable even to the intellect of the angels. He who is God by nature takes our humanity on himself and makes it his own in the womb of the Virgin, clothing himself in it as in a garment in order that we might partake in his divinity. He is God and man, but only one person, Jesus Christ, known in two natures, united, without mixture, without division, and without separation. Today, God becomes man in the cave at Bethlehem, in order that man may become God. God's aim and purpose in bringing forth all the things out of nothing and leading them into existence has been that the second person of the Holy Trinity might come down to us, take upon himself our humanity, grown old and deformed by sin, in order to heal our wounds by his sufferings, to cleanse his image defiled in us, and to renew us in himself, to rescue us from the abyss of death into which we have fallen, and to bring us to the heights of heaven, above all celestial powers, even so far as to enthrone us together with him in God. Jesus Christ, the Savior, Emmanuel, God with us, is born today as a tender babe upon whom the angels gaze with awe. The true light that enlightens every man has come into the world, has shone in the darkness of a poor stable, and the time of death and corruption is nearing its end. Solomon no longer has cause to exclaim that there is nothing new under the sun. For this day, a small child has become the second Adam and has brought about a new creation, a new humanity into being. Henceforth, by following Christ, by obeying his commandments, and by suffering with him, in order to arise through him, mankind is called to find immortality. The Word has become flesh. He has taken our sickness on himself and has compassion on our weakness. Though having no share in our offense, he assumed a body and a soul, and as a small child has submitted to the conditions of our fallen world, that is growth, hunger, thirst, sleep, lack of knowledge, without ever having committed sin. He alone is without sin and has come to dwell in the flesh, which is the subject to sin and to death, in order that the flesh may become the Word. He has taken upon himself a body destined for the tomb. He has covered it with glory and light by making it share in his immortality. For as the whole fullness of the Godhead dwells bodily in him, so those who follow him share with him in this fullness in their whole being, in their spirit, in their soul, in their body. Today, in keeping the feast of the incarnation of the Word, the descent of God among men, we confess the accomplishment of the whole mystery of our redemption. Christ is born, and man therefore becomes heir to glory. Certainly a little child in a crib is all that meets our eyes. But taught by the holy fathers, we see the signs of the completion of the mystery of Christ in the humble cave of Bethlehem. Christmas and Easter, these feasts of feasts, together one and the same solemnity, this cave foretells the tomb. The swaddling bands prefigure the winding sheet. Here Christ appears in the world, leaving the virginity of his mother without blemish, and there he will triumph over death and come forth from the tomb without breaking its seals. At Bethlehem, an angel is sent to the shepherds. And Jerusalem, a radiant angel announces the resurrection to the myrrh-bearing women. Always and everywhere, one and the same Christ, becoming man like to ourselves, even unto death, in order that the transgression committed by one man, Adam, might be removed for us by one man, the second Adam. For there is one God, and one mediator between God and man, the man Jesus Christ, who gave himself as a ransom for us all. Today, all beings in heaven and on earth bow down before him as Savior and Lord, and rejoice with great joy at being reconciled to God by him in his body, which is the Holy Church, the fullness of all him who fills all things. Christ is born. Amen.